Hey guys, it's Mark Oakley here with another episode of From the Drawing Board. And today we're in my little backyard. It's a little overgrown. We need to do a little bit of mowing. We have a little fire pit, which we haven't used in a while. There's a little chair over there, some stacked wood. That's all got to come inside at some point. Anyway, I went into town because I thought, oh, I'm going to, you know, sit out and do a little video, but man, it was jumping today, because today is Monday, and there's time off for everybody, so everyone's out going for walks, because it's Thanksgiving weekend here in Canada, and I couldn't find a spot that wasn't, you know, seeing tons of foot traffic. There was this little sort of enclosed area beside the library that's got these big tall bushes and a little bench. And while I was sitting there, you know, this little family came through and there's trucks and cars and people chatting, and I was a little self-conscious just sort of starting a monologue in the middle of like a crowd, right? I always think that looks a little odd, so I didn't want to be that guy. So I thought, you know what, I'll just go, you know, back to the house and sit in the backyard. There's nobody out here. Although, man, I didn't know what this was, because I'd hear these bangs every now and then. And I thought, what is that? Is that like construction? No, bam! I was like, huh. Maybe there's some grapevines, you know, some grape farms in the area, and sometimes they put up bird bangers to sort of scare off the crows and whatnot. But that wasn't it. And then I learned, no, those are hunters. And they shouldn't be hunting this close to sort of dwellings, but I guess there's no enforcement out here. So you get it sort of early in the morning because, man, there's a lot of wildlife out here, you know, like you'll be driving along and on the side of the road you'll see wild pheasants. And so that's just, you know, Thanksgiving coming up, you can hop out and bag a couple of those, you're looking pretty good, right? But it does sort of make me think, maybe if I'm going to go for a walk in the woods, I should get one of those like fluorescent orange jackets just to be sure, you know. These are the kinds of concerns I never thought about before, and especially not from city living. And for many years I lived right, you know, right in town, or, you know, a 2-minute walk away from downtown. So you didn't have to worry about getting shot, you know, by a rogue rifle shot. Okay. Anyway, out here things are a little different. But anyway, what I wanted to shoot this video of is, like, so I got this book. This is a Mark Twain book, and I posted that video a couple weeks ago, where it was down at the used bookstore. And man, I'm really liking it. And I was reading a bit of it, and a couple of things came up that I thought would be really fun to share. One of which, oh, this is neat. Check this out. So this is this book, right? And it's got this really nice soft cover. Like Jim at the Odd Book had several copies, and this is the one I picked. It was had a sort of a damaged spine, so, you know, after reading it, it's probably going to fall apart. But it's got this sort of soft faux leather. You know, it's like a 100-year-old book, I think, and, well, maybe not 100 years, but it's pretty darn old. And but it feels really good. It has this. It feels like one of, like a really old, like an old Bible, printed on thicker paper. I find Bible paper a little bit too thin to read comfortably. Anyway, I was down at one of the local a couple nights ago, you know, businesses for, you know, food, and I wanted to go get a coffee and just sort of settle in. But all the restaurants were like super packed, and I didn't want to get in anybody's way because I was just going to buy a coffee and sit there for like an hour. And so there's this little ice cream shop that I found that wasn't that busy. So I sat down there with a little scoop of like this amazing organic sort of in-house made ice cream. And I sometimes have, you know, I allow myself a sweet thing now and again because it has sugar in it. I'm doing that ketogenic diet and have been for several years now. And you stay away from sugars because they don't make you feel good. But ice cream every now and then, I'll let myself do that. So I'm sitting there just reading Mark Twain, and kind of oblivious to the world, eating my ice cream, and half an hour goes by. And then as I'm, you know, and then like this napkin slides into view. And I was like, huh? Someone next to me or someone across the restaurant had come over and slid a little napkin. And I'll show it to you. I got it right here. And it had a little drawing on it. And can you see that? It's a little picture of the girl who drew it. She's just wishing me a good day and hoping my autumn was nice. And it's this girl that I've met before. She's, you know, maybe like early 20s, and she wants to be an artist someday, and she's really cool and kind of shy, and so she saw me in this restaurant and didn't want to disturb me from reading, or maybe was too shy to come up, so she drew this little picture and just slid it to me, and I was like, and when I come out of a book, I'm sort of like, my brain's underwater. It takes me, you know, a minute to sort of swim to the surface after climbing out of the pool of literature, so all I could do was just sort of smile at her like, And we didn't say any words, and she just sort of took off into the night. And it was like, oh, that's really sweet. So now I've got this cool bookmark. So that's the story behind that. Anyway, let's get to the good stuff here. Page 18, you know, let's see here. I'll roll. I'm going to read some of this out. But first, I have to describe what the deal is with this. I didn't realize how important a book this was. So Mark Twain basically grew up on the Mississippi, and this is sort of a bunch of little stories and recollections of his life. And when this book was made, when it went to press, he hadn't finished Huckleberry Finn yet. And so he just said, well, he was trying to describe the character of some of the barge workers, because they would just sort of tie logs together and build these big rafts and put, like, you know, huts on them and go down the river delivering goods. That was sort of the commerce at the time. And he was trying to describe the kinds of people who, you know, the kind of workmen that worked that sort of lifestyle. And so he describes it a bit, and then by way of description, he said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to include this little excerpt from this project that I'm working on. You know, it's not going to be ready. I've been working on it for years, and maybe 6 years from now, maybe it'll be a book. I don't know. But here's a nice little piece. And he was talking about Huckleberry Finn. So this was like, I'm going, oh, I know it's coming. And it's been a long, long time since I read that book. And I only got halfway through it because I might have been, you know, maybe Huck's age. I might have been 13 or 14. I don't actually know how old Huckleberry Finn was in the story. Anyway, I was just a young guy, and I found it a very, very dense and difficult read. But I got about halfway through and had this sort of weird, you know, dreamlike memory of it, because the language was so not what I'd learned. It was all these abbreviations, and everyone who's read Huckleberry Finn knows, oh yeah, Mark Twain was taking some real liberties with the language to try and capture the accent of the characters and the colloquialisms of the time. So there's lots of apostrophes and stuff. But reading it here, I was like, oh, this is such a neat little piece. So there's two observations, or three, that I want to make. And the first is, well, this is just, I want to read this little piece out here because it really captures the, okay, here we go. He was trying to describe the sorts of workmen at the time. And he said, you know, they're like, let's see, I'm going to read the whole paragraph. The river's earliest commerce was in great barges, keelboats, broadhorns. They floated and sailed from the upper rivers to New Orleans, changed cargoes there, and were tediously warped and poled back by hand. The voyage down and back became sometimes occupied 9 months. 9 months on one river, eh? And this commerce increased until it gave employment to hordes of rough and hardy men. And this is you'll see where I'm going with this. Rude, uneducated, brave, suffering terrific hardships with sailor-like stoicism. Heavy drinkers, coarse frolickers in moral sights like the Natchez under the hill. Don't know what that is, of the day. Twain's sort of cultural references. Oh, that guy knew so much, and it's from the times. I don't know what Natchez under the hill means. But the Natchez under the hill of that day, they were heavy fighters, reckless fellows, everyone, elephantinely jolly, foul-witted, profane, prodigal with their money, bankrupt at the end of the trip, fond of barbaric finery, prodigious braggarts, yet, in the main, honest, trustworthy, faithful to promises and duty, and often, picturesquely, magnanimous. And I thought, oh, okay. So he took efforts to describe that a couple of times. Anyway, in the piece that, from Huckleberry Finn, he's trying to describe, so, okay, this is the second part. It was like, wow, when Twain writes, he sort of writes levels of story. So at this point in the narrative, Huckleberry Finn and Jim, who is an escaped slave, they're on the river and they're drifting downstream. They're looking for a particular port of call in another state where slavery had been abolished, and so that Jim could go free. And they you know, are on this epic journey, and you know, there's this one city that they were hoping to get to, but they drifted past it in the fog, so now they're lost in the river, and they come to this plan, well, we got to figure out where the heck we are. Huck, go swim out to one of those barges, climb aboard and listen in and try and get a hint as to, you know, where we are, because they're going to talk about, you know, where they're gonna, where the port of call is. We gotta get some bearings. And Huck's like, yeah, okay. So he strips down, dives in the water, swims out to this this raft with like a bunch of guys on it. There's like 13 workmen on this raft. He climbs up and sort of hides behind, you know, in a bunch of bales of cargo, and he's listening in. And so now you're in the middle of this, oh yeah, are they gonna find their way? But then you start hearing the dialogue of the men on board this ship, and there's a fight that almost starts, and then they get down to telling stories, and one of them's telling a ghost story, and then you slip into his dialogue, and he's describing characters, and so now you're in this ghost story, which is being told of another time. So you're like three levels in, you're like, well, actually four, because like you're in a book about the Mississippi, and then Twain takes a segment from another book about the Mississippi, and then within that, there's a story of Huckleberry Finn. He gets on the barge and he's listening to another story. It's like, by the time, it's like that movie Inception, you're like four or five narrative levels down, and you're just like, whoa, you know? And it's so easily done. I was like, it's really brilliant. Anyway, so he's describing this ridiculous fight that almost starts between these two big thugs. I just gotta check the time here. Oh man, we're at 10 minutes. I'm gonna make this a longer video, so, you know, here, I'm gonna keep on going. So there's this song circle, and this one guy singing, and it's like a long song with lots of verses. He's not doing it well. And finally, one of the big guys is like, shut up, or I'm going to beat the crap out of you, right? And he stands up, and he's like, "Arr!" And then another guy leaps to the defense of the singer and says, no, you're not, and I'm tougher than you. And this is the paragraph. And, you know, then he jumped up in the air and cracked his heels together again and shouted out, whoop, whoop! I am the old original iron-jawed, brass-mounted, copper-bellied corpse-maker from the wilds of Arkansas. He's boasting, right? And that seems to be what this is all about, these big guys boasting. Not even really punching each other, just, like, talking. You know, look at me, I'm the man they call sudden death and general desolation. Sired by a hurricane, damned by an earthquake, half-brother to the cholera, nearly related to the smallpox on the mother's side. Look at me! I take 19 alligators and a barrel of whiskey for breakfast when I'm in robust health, and a bushel of rattlesnakes and a dead body when I'm ailing. I split the everlasting rocks with my glance, and I quench the thunder when I speak. Whoop, whoop! Stand back and give me room according to my strength. Blood's my natural drink, and the wails of the dying is my music to my ear. Cast your eye on me, gentlemen, and lay low and hold your breath, for I'm about to turn myself loose. You know? And I'm like, what the heck, man? And the guy that he's like, challenging, gets up and says the same kind of thing, these big, long, you know, poetic paragraphs of how tough they are, you know, and then they're sort of like, you know, flicking each other's hats off and not really laying any blows. And then finally a third guy gets up and says, you two idiots, you know, in his own way, basically come here, you're cowards and braggarts, and I'll make short work of both of you, and does, you know, and Huck Finn describes, and he kicked them down and knocked them around the deck, and they couldn't get back up, and when he was finally done, they were begging for him to stop, and then he made them make amends, he made the two shake hands, and they admit, yeah, I actually had a lot of respect for you, it's pretty good, you know, everything's cool, no hard feelings, and they all sat down again, and it's just like, and that was just entertainment for the evening. I was like, oh my god, what energy, you know? Anyway, the realization that I had, and Huck Finn sort of hiding and watching all this, eventually they discover him and they pull him out and they say, what's this boy doing here, you know? And I realized, oh, when I opened up Thieves and Kings long ago, Huck Finn had been stuck in my head. That was a major part of who Rubel is. You know, living on ships, tough as nails, sweet and nice and heartfelt. I think he probably had, he was better read, I think, and more literate than Huck was. Huck was illiterate, but, you know, Quentin had taught Rubel how to read and write. But for the most part, he was this wild animal, you know, put onto a ship and made tough, and that's Rubel. And his grandfather came from the same sort of ilk as these big, tough men, you know? And I realized, oh my gosh, I'm revisiting the roots of these characters. And it's interesting because in the story, I've drifted into other characters' lives, but Rubel is still, he still has a vibrant life, and he's got things to learn still. So I'm looking forward to writing more about him. So I find it interesting that when I do find a book, I'll pull it off the shelf, and it's the one that my instinct says, yeah, read this, you'll see. And I do, and I realize that, oh, there's patterns that link up beyond my mind, and they're sort of out in the world, and when I follow those patterns, I wind up with nice books like this. And anyway, So that's a longer video for today, but I wanted to sit down and share that with you. Happy Thanksgiving to my Canadian brothers and sisters, and join me again for another video. Hit like and subscribe, leave any comments below, and check out my Patreon page if you'd like to become a supporter. And have a wonderful Thanksgiving, and have a great day. Love you all. Bye.